neither height nor depth can separate us. Hell and death will not defeat us. He who gave his son to free us holds me in his love. And neither height nor depth can separate.
Victory in it.
Everything inside of me, I raise up.
passion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me, and everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. And Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe.
Came ready to worship today. That was amazing. You sense God's presence here today. He is among us. We are going to take communion together today, the Lord's Supper. Jesus told us after he left, do this in remembrance of me. So I'm going to ask those who are helping with the communion day to come forward. I've drafted my wife Marcy in today. We got another big crowd, so I'm going to have three rows here. Pastor Rocky, can you hand those out to them for me, please? Nancy, if you just go over there, Butch will put you in the middle, Marcy over there. You can just go to whichever person that you want to go to. But as they prepare and as we prepare our hearts, I'd like to read from our Nazarene manual on what it has to say about our communion. The communion supper, instituted by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as a sacrament which proclaims His life, His sufferings, His sacrificial death and resurrection, and the hope of His coming again. It shows forth the Lord's death until His return. Hear these words. The supper is a means of grace in which Christ is present by His Spirit. Let that sink in. Christ is present among us today. I went to a baseball game last night where they were cheering players, and I was too. I'm not putting them down, but Christ is here. He's in our midst. It is to be received in reverent appreciation and gratefulness for the work of Christ. All those who are truly repentant, forsaking their sins and believing in Christ for salvation, are invited to participate in the death and resurrection of Christ. We come to the table that we may be renewed in life and salvation, not saved by it, but renewed in it, and made one by the Spirit. In unity with the church, we confess our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Amen. If you would now turn and face the crowd, I'm going to pray a prayer as we enter into this. Nancy, you can go ahead and go on over to that side. I'm going to pray a prayer, and you can just go to whichever side that you choose to go to. Don't feel like you have to rush through this. If you want to wait, you can wait. If you'd like to come kneel at the altar, you can come kneel. You can sit at your seat. The only thing we ask is that you currently have a relationship with Jesus, and that you wait until all of us have been served so that we can take this meal together as a family. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thank you that you're already here. We welcome you. We invite you. We ask for you, God. We even plead for you. We need you. So be here among us. Feed us spiritually by your grace. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. The table is open, Christian. Come eat with your Savior.
There is one gospel on which I stand for all eternity. It is my story, my Father's plan. The Son has rescued me. Still alive. wild story that rescued me. Praise to my Savior, the King of life. I stand in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Praise to my Savior, the King of life. I stand in the gospel of Jesus Christ. I stand in the gospel of Jesus Christ.
I like that song. How about you? We gather at this, your table, Lord, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who by your Spirit was anointed to preach good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captives, set at liberty those who are oppressed. Christ, you healed the sick, you fed the hungry, you ate with sinners, and established the new covenant for the forgiveness of our sins. We live in the hope of the coming of your coming again. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, he gave thanks, broke it, and said, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat." Then he took the cup and he gave thanks to his disciples. He said, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my covenant, which is poured out for you in the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Jesus, thank you for your presence among us. I pray that everyone here today would hear these words. In me, you are good enough. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we're going to take a moment to pray. A kind of a sad day for us here at Harrisonville Church of the Nazarene. Our guitar player is leaving for college what day?
Wednesday?
Okay. So this is her last Sunday with us for a while, so she'll be back to see us from time to time, but we want to do what we did for Kaylee. Kaylee was here her last Sunday, so we want to take time to pray for her. So Greta and the family, if you come on down, any of the family who are here with us who'd like to come forward at this time, raise a hallelujah. We'll never be the same without Greta, will it? That's an amazing song. Worship will not be the same. And just a word that if you play guitar or sing, we're going to be coming after you in very short order. So I'm going to ask the rest of the church, anybody who would like to come now at this time, to come. And we want to send Greta off with our love and our prayers. Thank you, Greta, for your faith, your example, your service. You've been an amazing testimony for Jesus. And all these people gathered around you, love you, and we'll be praying for you. Father, thank you for Greta, for her strong faith, for the witness of her worship on Sunday mornings, for her faithfulness here every time that she can be here. God, we pray that as she leaves for school and college, God, that this anointing that you've placed on her would be expanded and used for your glory to touch many lives for the kingdom of God. God, we pray that you would guide her in every key decision that's coming up in the days ahead. In these next 4 years, huge, huge decisions will be made. We thank you for the Christian college that she's going to be at as she makes these decisions. We pray that the foundation that has been laid would continue to be strong. Thank you for her family, for the example that they've been and the foundation they've laid and their faithfulness to you. Minister to them in these days. Give them your peace. Be with Greta. Give her your peace. Give her the assurance that these songs that she's led us in these past couple of years, that they're true. We can raise a hallelujah in the middle of the storm. We already have the victory. Jesus has risen again, and she will face nothing that he can't handle. So, Lord, we come and we lift up your name. We pray that in the rest of this service that you'd continue to be glorified and honored. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Can we give Greta a big hand clap and show of appreciation and love? For all that she's done for us. We will certainly miss her. We're going to do announcements at the end. I think you have a song, or we're gonna let's sing a song. Pastor Rocky's gonna come preach after this song is over. For us today.
In my moments of fear, through every pain, every tear, there's a God who's been faithful to me. And when my strength was all gone, when my heart had no song, still in love he's proved faithful to me. Every word he's spoken is true. What I thought was impossible, I see my God do. He's been faithful, faithful to me. Looking back, his love and mercy, even failed to believe, yet he's been faithful, faithful to me. And when my heart looked away, the many times I could not pray, faithful to me. The days I spent so selfishly reaching out for what pleased me, even then God was faithful.
Check up here, Pastor. Is that something we ought to take care of from the Finleys? A check for $57 on their anniversary. Where are you guys? Praise God. Amen. Praise the Lord. One other thing I want to A couple of things I want to draw to your attention before we get into the scriptures here. Jody handed me a note about there's a court appearance for Jeff, her grandson, coming up this week. Many of us have been praying for Jeff and Isla. Isla is his little daughter, Jody's great-granddaughter, and for a custody issue there, and we've been really praying about that. And Marcy's mom has been very, very ill this week. Her name is Barb. How's she doing now? Do we know? Okay. We know she's spending time, been in the hospital now in rehab, but pray for Barb, if you would, as a family, and we appreciate that. Good to have all of you here today, and always good to be in the presence of the Lord, isn't it? To enjoy just what God can do in our lives. And I was asked to preach long before the pastor, and then decided he was going to be here anyway. And I said, well, you can preach. I don't have to preach. But he said, no, you go ahead. So we're going to be in Hebrews, the sixth chapter this morning. And and let's dismiss the children. Yes, that didn't get done. We're going to dismiss all of our children at Children's Church just now. Follow Miss Abby that way. There she is in the back. So we appreciate Miss Abby doing that and leading that ministry for us. Praise God. Good to have all of you here again today and trusting God's blessing your life. We had a great time Thursday night at dinner church. One of the Sunday school classes, Randy Strickland Sunday school class, prepared all the food and served. And we just had a great time of testimonies from Ron Wellhoff and Ernie. And Ernie sang, and we just had a super time. So good that you can be here today. In Hebrews, the sixth chapter, we have it up on the screen for you here. This is from the what's called the New English Translation. Beginning at verse 11 in your Bibles. And if you do not have a Bible, you're brand new Christian, brand new to our church, if you don't have a Bible, please, please say something to myself or to Pastor Steve. We will get you a Bible. We want all of our people to have a Bible and to be into the Word of God, reading it on a regular basis, and let God just feed your soul. And that's what we're going to do here this morning. We're just going to gather around the scriptures together. Is that okay? And it's not me speaking up here. It's really God's Word just speaking to us. And I'm just going to kind of unfold the scriptures and just allow the Holy Spirit to apply it to our lives this morning. Beginning at chapter 6 and verse 11. But we passionately want each of you to demonstrate the same eagerness for the fulfillment of your hope until the end, so that you may not be sluggish, but imitators of those who through faith and perseverance inherit the promises. Let me kind of set this up a little bit for you here. We're stepping into the middle of a conversation from, I believe, the Apostle Paul. I believe wrote this, and he's writing to these Hebrew Christians. And his mission, his goal at this moment, is one of encouragement, of building their hope and their confidence in God. And on the opposite side of that, he wants to see them remain faithful to God, not quitting the faith when the going gets tough, but staying with it, sticking with it, though the times are difficult under these circumstances for these early Christians. And so he is urging them to be passionate about and eager about the faith and about all that goes into being and living the Christian life. On the other hand, the opposite of that is the word sluggish. You'll notice in verse 12, if we can go back to that verse, can you go back to that, Caden, at all? In verse 12, you see the word sluggish. It's a word that means, and it's a little difficult for us to translate into English, but it would be something like you and I may say at times, don't slack off. Don't be a slacker. Don't be a slacker. Now that's a referring to our walk with the Lord. These are not times when it is difficult and hard on us in these circumstances and culture we live in. These are not times to back away from God, but draw close to God and be diligent about that. Press in on that and not be the quitter And so he is saying to us, I'm going to encourage you today, and I as well as the one who's preaching here, do my best to encourage and impress upon you the need and urgency for, in a word, hope today. The title of my message you'll find is coming up here in a moment is the matter of the anchor of my soul. The anchor of my soul is Jesus and my hope in Christ, and that I am fixed on this. In the 12th chapter of Hebrews, the writer here says, we are to fix our eyes on Jesus. That's kind of like where I go like this to you. And you're setting your eyes, not on me, but on Jesus. When the going gets tough and the circumstances are hard for us, and we don't always have the answer for things, what should we do? Who do we look to? And the scriptures say to us in various ways, fix your eyes on Jesus. Set him as the one that you keep before you at all times. So now, let's go to verse 13 and read on. So he says, now, when God made his promise to Abraham, since he could not swear by no one greater, he swore by himself. He's giving an example now of a promise that God had made to Abraham, as we know in the Old Testament. You'll find it in about the 12th chapter of Genesis, the 15th chapter of Genesis. It's repeated about three times in the book of Genesis. God repeats his promise, and in a nutshell, here's the promise. He says in verse 14, surely I will bless you greatly and multiply your descendants abundantly. That may not mean a lot to you and me, but at the time of Abraham and circumstances he was going through, he and his wife Sarah were childless. That was a very difficult thing for them. When God had already promised to them, as he does here, I'm going to multiply you. I'm going to bless you. You're going to become, your offspring are going to become as the sand of the seashore, as the stars in the sky. In fact, God repeats that in three different ways to them, saying to Abraham, I'm going to bless you. I promise you a child. Now, many of us know, if you read through your Bible much, you know that Abraham and Sarah waited for how long for that child to come? Anybody remember? 25 years. 25 years. From the time that God gave him that promise to the time that that child was born. That's a long time to wait. Would you agree with me? It's a long time to wait. It's a long time that you're wondering, well, God, where are you? You said this to me. I believe this. You made this promise to me. You spoke this. I don't believe you just threw this out in midair and made this up to make me feel good. Lord, you're saying that you're going to do some great things through me and my wife and my family. God, where is this? Anybody goes through that kind of circumstance and situation. We wonder. We question. And let me say to some of us here today something I just want to impress on you. It's okay to question God. It's a whole nother matter to doubt God. It's okay to ask questions because, Lord, I want to understand. I want to know. I need you to teach me. Question. But it's a whole nother matter, and we've gone too far when we simply and have come to the point where I doubt God. I've thrown in the towel. I'm ready to quit. I just don't know if I can go on like this anymore. But so what God is doing here through Paul, the writer here, is encouraging them, the people that he's writing to, even as God did to Abraham, his promises are still active and working today. And so he says this in verse 15, and so by persevering, Abraham inherited the promise. For people swear by something greater than themselves, and the oath serves as a confirmation to end all dispute. In the same way, God wanted to demonstrate more clearly to the heirs of the promise that his purpose was unchangeable. And so he intervened with an oath so that we who have found refuge in him, meaning God, may find strong encouragement to hold fast to the hope set before us through two unchangeable things. Since it is impossible for God to lie, we have this hope as an anchor of the soul, sure and steadfast. which reaches inside behind the curtain. Now let me just kind of open up and unfold these scriptures a little more for us today. The whole message here that he's giving to us is one of hope. And he puts it in a form to help these folks and we as well to understand. He puts it in the form of an anchor of the soul. This is the only place in the scripture where this phrase is even used. God is saying to you and to me today that when we put our hope in him, especially that is Christ, for our salvation and even for the present experiences of this life, when we put our hope in him for our future and for present circumstances and present needs, he's saying it is as though you threw out an anchor that will hold fast, that will not give way in the times of storm and difficulty and hardship. This is a message that he is writing to those, I believe, that were full of doubt. And many, even Christians today, can be full of doubt. Some of you struggle with doubts about God, about your unworthiness before God. Does he even mean what he says? This is a message that I believe he expresses to those who are even full of fear. Some of us would have to admit there are things that we're afraid of. We're fearful of, is it going to happen as God says it? Can I be sure that God will see me through it when the doctor is giving me this information about my health right now and a surgery that's ahead for me? Can I be certain of God in these kinds of circumstances and experiences? There are some of us who find ourselves full of anxiety, just unsure of the future. I can't see it. I can't put my hand on it. I don't know how it's going to turn out. I go through in my mind, do you do this? I go through all the what ifs. The what ifs. Well, what about this, God? And what if this happens? And see, this is where the Lord Jesus comes up to you and to me. And I have to look at it this way. I have to look at it as my Heavenly Father coming down to me. And he takes me by the hand. And even though I don't know the way through, even though I can't see it, he walks me through it. And all my job is, all your job is just hold his hand. Hold his hand. Because I am trusting that my God knows just the way through. I am trusting that he can see what I can't see. He can see around the corner when I can't even see into tomorrow. He knows the days ahead and the circumstances that are ahead. My job is simply this: hold on to him. Many years ago, my oldest son and I went on a men's fishing trip with a bunch of guys from our church. We were in eastern Washington, a beautiful area up in the mountains. And we went to a beautiful lake that we all enjoyed going to for fishing. And we spent a couple of nights, spent the weekend there and had our own worship service there and so forth. And I believe it was on a Friday night, we had done a bunch of fishing, my son and I and all the other guys and their kids, and caught quite a lot of fish. And so the day was drawing to the end, and up in the north there, the days are quite short in the state of Washington. It can get dark about 4 in the afternoon. And so we were all kind of wrapping it up, heading to our cabins, and got a pretty decent night's sleep. If you can count how many guys were snoring at that time, you were probably imagining you were sleeping. The next morning we got up, several guys had brought their boats to get out on the lake. There were some rowboats if guys wanted to use them, but some guys had brought their power boats and so forth. And we got up and it was a beautiful morning. Fog was hanging low on the ground. It was cool out. My son and I got up and we kind of walked down toward the lake. Where the pier was, and several of the boats were tied up. But we looked off in the distance, and there was one boat that apparently had come untied from the dock and had drifted off into the middle of the lake. And We thought, okay, who didn't do the job of tying up that boat? But we didn't find fault. We didn't look for who was guilty and so on and so forth. But it became a lesson for me to share with then my very, very young son. I pulled Eric aside and I began to talk to him about how very important it is for you, my son, to tie your life up to Jesus. Can you see it? Just you've come and you've tied your boat up to the dock, and I said, son, this is a lesson for you and for me. Tie your life up to Jesus. He will always hold you secure. He is the anchor of our soul. Some of us here today going through some challenging things in life, circumstances that are difficult, and you haven't always felt comfortable in sharing with everybody else in church, please pray for me and so forth. But you know what I'm talking about. And today you can be absolutely sure of the future and even the todays when you have anchored your life to Jesus. Hope is an interesting thing. I want to say this morning, when the Bible talks about hope here, the Bible never uses the word hope as wishful thinking. Hope is not wishful thinking. I'm looking at Shirley back here. She's shaking her head. Many of you have experienced it. You know, all the old timers here saying to you younger ones, hope is not just wishful thinking. I hope it'll all come about. Hope is not just some imagining of things as we'd like to see them. But to the Bible, in the Bible, hope is an absolute certainty of the future because you know God has it all in His hands. Hope in the Bible is something you can joyfully expect. I'm looking forward to it because God has said it. And I am sure of it because of what God has said. It's a hope that isn't just simply passing and fleeting and we're just depending on circumstances. Even when circumstances aren't good, I'm absolutely sure of my God. He will see you through. He can carry you through any circumstance. And this is a hope that is a certainty. I'm anchored to this. I'm banking on this. I'm absolutely confident in my God like this. And folks, we need to go into our circumstances and into this world with that kind of an assurance deep inside of us that our God does answer prayer. Amen. Our God is still out there on the throne on the universe. He is not fleeting. He's not some God that's fickle and somehow I can't be sure of Him. In fact, I believe, and I do want to point out, there are four facts here in these scriptures that the writer here gives to us about God. For if we're to talk about hope that we can be sure of, a hope that really grounds us in the most difficult of circumstances, a hope that gives us an assurance of eternity in heaven today, I want you to know there is a God out there who is the one upon which we base our hope. The first thing He tells us in the Scriptures is that He is a God who is unchangeable. He is unchangeable. Look at verse 18 for an example. And well, actually, you could go to verse 17, Caden, if you're there. Look at verse 17 with me. Can you bring that up? It says here that His purpose was unchangeable. And then it'll later say in verse 18, Caden, go there for me, would you? That there are two unchangeable things. What you need to know about God here today is this. God is unchangeable. I keep falling back on scriptures that help me when I'm going through some times and circumstances that aren't pleasant. Not the good times. These are the tough times. And I fall back on scriptures that I run them through my mind in things like this. When I say that God is unchangeable, I think of Hebrews, the 13th chapter. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and what? Forever. He's the same. The same God. The same God that Moses prayed to that David prayed to, the same God that Abraham prayed to, is the same God who we pray to today, and his promises are true today. That's the second thing you'll see in these scriptures about God. It talks about his promises. Look at verse 17 again. In verse 17, he talks about in the same way God wanted to demonstrate more clearly to the heirs of the promise. Who made that promise? God made that promise. God makes promises to you and to me. And let me tell you this. God never breaks a promise. Have you ever had somebody break their promise to you? Just nod your head up and down like that. Just, I know you're not the only one here. I know for a fact that's happened in my life. How can you be sure of that person from here on? But I'm saying to you today, according to God's word, God never breaks a promise. In fact, the book of Joshua, in two different places, Joshua says, there has not failed even one of his promises. King Solomon, over in 1 Kings chapter 5, Solomon says, there has not failed even one of his promises. And I imagine, can you imagine, that in this Bible, there are thousands, literally thousands of promises that God has made, and they are still true today. How many of you have a dollar bill in your pocket? Admit it. You do? I'll be collecting that as soon as we're done here in church. Every preacher collects an offering. No, I'm teasing you. You have a dollar bill in your pocket. You got a dollar bill in your wallet. You may have a dollar bill at bank. You have a dollar bill at home. We've been printing those dollar bills for a long time, haven't we? That dollar bill, 100 years ago, still the same dollar bill. If you had a dollar bill that's 100 years old, it's still the same today. It's going to buy a dollar's worth of whatever today. Of course, by inflation, by whomever is in charge of this place, inflation's kind of making a difference there, what a dollar will buy. But it's still the same. You still use it. You don't throw that away because, well, that dollar bill's an old one. I need a new one. Well, if you're going to throw any of them away, give them to me, okay? It's still good. I have silver dollars at my house that were given to us years ago. And some of them date back quite old. That silver dollar is still a silver dollar. You still use it as a dollar. Folks, God is the same. And his promises hold true today. Bless God. And so here's where I'm at when I'm in these circumstances. And I recommend this to you as well. When I'm going through some challenging situation or I need an answer from God, I'm saying, Lord, give me a promise from your word. Give me a promise from your word that I can hang on to, that I can anchor to, oh God, and you will carry me through in this because you have promised it. And does it mean that it'll be true to you and true for your situation? I believe so. God's word is still God's word. He hasn't changed it. He's unchangeable. There's another thing that we see about God in these scriptures right here. I want to draw to your attention in verse 17 again. It says that he intervened with an oath. And it said back in verse 14, Caden, take us back to verse 14. Surely, do you see that? Surely, he says. He made this promise, but notice he says, surely. What is that? That is God swearing, that is, taking an oath. He not only has made the promise to Abraham, and he's made his promises to you and to me, but what God has done is he has taken an oath against himself that I will hold these promises true and valid and real throughout eternity. He says, surely this is for you. He has taken an oath. Have you ever taken an oath? I know some of our medical people here, I know Dr. Maxwell's taken an oath. Our nurses that are here, they took an oath to do no harm. Our law enforcement people, is Andy here today? Julie's not here. Andy's taken an oath to protect the Constitution and the laws of the state of Missouri. Am I right? Some of you have taken an oath through the military. You military fellows, have you had to take an oath? Have you ever been to court? No confessions here, but have you ever been to court? And you visit a courtroom, and there was a day when someone would step into the witness stand. And the court clerk would come up to that witness and say, raise your hand. Put your hand on the Bible. You remember those days? How many of you are old enough to remember that? And they would make you take an oath. I swear to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help me God. We don't say that anymore. Have you noticed that ever? They'll say, I swear to tell the truth, nothing but the truth, but they leave the last part out. Things have changed, haven't they? But let me tell you today, God took an oath against himself because he could not swear to anyone higher or bigger or greater, saying that all these holy promises and these scriptures I present to you in my word is holding true to you today. I swear it by my own name. I will not back up on this. I will never quit on this. God is saying, my word holds true throughout eternity. Can you take hope in that? Can you see ahead to what God may not yet have revealed the whole thing, but yet I know my God is going to take my hand and walk me through this? Praise God. Somebody say amen. There's another thing. One more fact here we need to bring out about God the scriptures tell us about. He says, it is impossible for God to lie. Think of it. It is impossible for God to lie. He says that again over in the book of Titus in chapter 1. It is impossible for God to lie. It's a good thing my son's not here today. I'm going to tell a story on him. When I was a young dad, we were living in Sacramento, California, pastoring a church there. My oldest son was big time into bike racing, BMX bikes. And he was into it big time. We got trophies galore of him winning races in competition. And he was always working on his bike. My son Eric is quite good with his hands, very mechanical. And he was constantly working on his bike, trying to improve it, trying to make it better. He changed the sprockets on it to try to get more speed. He would change the pedals on it to get a better grip when he was jumping over the moguls and turns and everything else. And so it was just a constant thing in our house. The garage was always full of something that he was tearing apart on his bike, and he'd get a hold of parts and whatever. And I noticed that one day when I came home that there were some parts to a bike that I didn't recognize, and I wondered where he got them. And he said to me, I asked him about it, I said, son, where'd you get those bike parts? And he said, well, I bought them from a friend. I said, oh, okay. Well, that evening, Jeanette had made a great dinner for us, and we were all, four of us were sitting around the table and in the kitchen there, and all of a sudden, while we're in the middle of our dinner, there's a knock at the door. And I went to the door to answer and see who it was, and it was another little kid, a friend of Eric's. Torres was his name. And Torres, a Hispanic kid, I greet him at the door, and I said, Torres, what's up? And he said, well, I came for my money. And I said, what money is that? And he said, well, the money that Eric owes me. And I said, really? I said, but he told me, and I'm thinking in my mind, he bought these. He paid for them. And I said, oh, okay. Well, I said, Torres, I'll see to it that you get your money, so I'll get back to you about it. And I closed the door, and I went back into the kitchen, and I said to Eric, looked him right in the eye, love him to death, love him today. And I said, son, you lied to me. Boy, his head hung down. He hadn't paid anything. He hadn't done what he said he did. He lied to me. And I was so upset. You ever get upset at your kids? Somebody help me feel better here, okay? You ever get upset with your kids? You love them to death. You want the best for them. But I just couldn't tolerate him lying to me, because I depended on him always telling me the truth for his own good and safety. So I said, son, I want you to stand here at the door, which was the door from the kitchen into the garage. I opened the door and had it remain open where his bike was, and I went into the garage, and this is my confession here, okay? I picked up his bike, raised it up over my head, and I slammed it to the concrete ground as hard as I could. I did that again, and I did that again until it was not rideable anymore. Now, don't sit in judgment at me. Come on. I was one frustrated dad. I was upset. Telling the truth meant that much to me, between me and my son. Because if I can't trust you, if I don't know you're telling me the truth, how do I know I can trust you tomorrow or next week or ever? Do you see? God can't afford to lie. If he lied one time, would you ever trust him again? You'd always have that element of doubt, wouldn't you? You'd always have that moment where you paused and wondered, well, I wonder if he's telling me the truth this time. And the Bible says, oh, bless God, it is impossible for God to lie. It's not even in him. He can't even do it. It doesn't even come out of him. And for these reasons, God is saying to us, he's unchangeable. He keeps his promises. He's taken an oath against himself that that promise is still going to be working 100 and 1,000,000 years from now. And in fact, that it is even impossible for God to lie. And thus God says to us, my hope in Jesus is the anchor of my soul. That I know that if I grab hold and hang on tight to Jesus, he will get me through this. He will take me all the way into eternity, and I'll have that heavenly home as my own. But oh, how much today we need hope. We need hope. There are some that have said, in fact, I remember a quote from a missionary, and I'll quit with this. Missionary's name was Jonathan Goforth. He was a missionary to China many, many years ago. And on one occasion, another Christian brother challenged him about his beliefs in God and even the reasons for praying. This particular brother said to Jonathan Goforth, I just can't fathom that God even cares or is interested in the puny things of life that we bring up sometimes in our prayers. Does it really matter to the God of the universe, who rules over everything, that you're missing your keys, or you don't have enough in the checkbook to cover this month's bills? Does it even matter to this God that this sickness isn't just going away. I mean, he's too busy. He's too great. And Jonathan Goforth thought for a moment, an experienced missionary, and he said in reply, "There is nothing too great for the power of God. And it is also true that there is nothing too small for God's love." Now think about that. There's nothing too great for God to deal with it and be able to handle this. But it is also true, there's nothing too small for God's love. See, you may be that person here today that's full of doubt. Remember, he's unchangeable. He keeps his promises. He swears to it. It is impossible for him to lie. You may be someone here today that's full of fear. Turn your fears over to Jesus. Put them in the hands of Jesus. You may be someone here today that's just run over by anxiety. I want to tell you today, just what the scripture says, have no anxiety about anything, but in everything, make your requests and supplications unto God with thanksgiving, and the God of peace will guard your hearts and your minds. Folks, I'm not making that up. That's Philippians, the 4th chapter. And so I leave you with this, just 2 thoughts for you. Pray. Don't quit praying. Don't give up your faith and prayer and trusting God about the needs of our lives and the eternity that we look forward to one day. I'm looking forward to heaven, aren't you? Praise God. Pray. Don't quit praying. And the second thing I want to just plug into your thinking is this. If you come here today and you're the person that has had your hope falter, it's all sort of slipped through your hands like water running through your hands, please, once again, put it in the hands of Jesus. Put it in the hands of Jesus. Let him take care of it. When I was a kid, my dad was an auto mechanic and quite good at it. I'm not. I didn't catch it. All I was good for was helping my dad. And so we frequently would have a car in the backyard of our house at the end of the driveway that my dad would be working on for a neighbor or a friend. And often my dad would have to have jacked up that car and probably have it on jack stands and whatever. He'd roll under the car on his creeper, his roller creeper thing, and he'd be working on that car. I'd be outside just kind of watching and so forth. I always was intrigued watching my dad and seeing what he could do and so forth. And so we'd be right in front of our garage. The garage door would be open, and there's a garage full of tools. And my dad would holler out to me, and he'd say, "Rock, go get me that box-end wrench, 1/4 inch on one side. Or Rock, get me that crescent wrench. Or Rock, go get me those adjustable pliers there. You know the right ones. Or Rock, I need a socket, 1/2 inch, deep, and I need it to be 3/8 drive." Now, I'm just a kid, okay, but I understood all that. And I'd go to the toolbox, and I'd grab the right tool. And my dad never came out from under the car. All I'd see is a hand sticking out there. And I'd slap it in his hand like a nurse does to the surgeon, you know. And I'd just slap it in his hand, and he'd just go right back to work. He'd be done with that, and he'd throw it down the side, and he'd say, "Now, Rock, I need that ball-peen hammer." I'd go to the toolbox. I knew the drawer that it was in. I'd grab that ball-peen hammer. I'd walk back over there where my dad is, and the hand is sticking out there like that. I'd put that ball-peen hammer into his hand, and he'd go right back to work. And I learned something. That's exactly what we do when we call on God in prayer. And then at times we must put whatever it is into his hands, and we trust him to do the job. I never questioned my dad about, well, are you doing the right thing? Do you know what you're doing? Is that really how you should do this? Or did you get the right? I never questioned him. My dad was the expert. Besides, if he questioned me, he'd smack me in the head, you know. No, I trust him. And eventually he'd come out from under that car and the job was done and we'd start picking up the tools and I knew right where to put them. But I learned this, which is what we all must learn. This is what you're doing when you pray. You're giving God the tools he needs to get the job done. That's all you're doing. You're giving God the tools to get the job done. He needs your faith. He needs your praying. He needs your confidence in him. And when you do this, when you put all the right tools in his hand, he will get the job done, and I don't have to question him. I know he knows what he's doing. Amen. Amen. We're going to conclude just now with prayer. And this morning, if you just want Pastor and I or someone to pray with you this morning about something, we want you to feel free to allow us to do that. The worship team's going to lead us here in a moment. You might just play something there, brother. But we want to pray for you. We know there are some that are going through some things in your life. We're not here to embarrass you or call you out or such, but you just need somebody to pray with you, claim the promises of God with you, and trust God with you. You know, there's just always the need for us to lift one another sometimes. So let's stand to our feet just now, if you would. Join me in standing. If you want us to pray with you about something this morning, I want you to just feel free to come up here right now. Pastor's going to join me here, but we're going to pray for you. Don't be shy. You may be brand new here, never been here before, but this is a good time that we want to just pray for you and pray about that situation. And if anybody wants to be prayed for healing, we want to pray with you and anoint you with oil according to the scriptures today, and I know God will help us. Yes. Up here to ask us to pray with her for Audrey. She's going off to college this week. And I need some moms up here. We have any moms here? Come up here and join this lady, would you? Join Lori. Just add our faith to all this. And Jody has asked us to pray for Jeff, her grandson, and her great-granddaughter, Isla, going to court this week. It's been a very critical matter here about Isla's custody. And she had been taken by her mom and didn't know where she was for a long time, but suddenly God has brought her back. So I need some of you to pray with Jody here. And we've got Angie up here and Walter again. And I need some of you men, could I ask some of you fellas to come up here, please, and get around Walter and Angie right now, and just let's just encourage them and pray for them right here. We're right here. Angie and Walter, God's really working in their lives, and praise God for that. And we need to break some bondages here, and God is going to do that. Pastor, why don't you lead us?
Come to you today. We lift up Jody to you. We ask you for this situation that she's facing. We thank you that you turn the hearts of kings and judges, and you are in complete control of this situation. Father, we pray for peace, pray for wisdom and discernment for everybody involved. We pray for every person involved, what's best for them. We claim the promise of your word that you have a good plan for each one of us. You desire the best. As we've heard today, you're a good father who loves us and only wants what is best for us. So, Lord, we're here today to ask for your good, pleasing, and perfect will for you to come and to do what only you can do. Lord, we're reminded that when there seems to be no way, you will make a way. And God, we're asking you to do that in this situation. You've already done a lot. Now we're just asking for you to finish the deal, and we'll give you the glory for it, Lord. Lord, we lift up Lori to you today in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Brad, and we lift up Audrey as she goes off to school this week, and we pray that you'd minister to her, give her peace, give this family your peace, give Audrey your direction, surround her with your presence, put a hedge of protection around her, God. Thank you for the foundation that she's been given. Give this family grace and peace and strength in the days ahead. May Audrey know your good, pleasing, and perfect will for her life. Bring healing, Father. Bring hope. Bring wholeness to this family and this situation. Just give them the supernatural peace of God that surpasses all understanding. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And Lord, we lift up Walter and Angie to you. Thank you that they are part of our church family. We ask you, God, to give them the grace and the peace of God. We ask you to provide the right place to live at the right time. We pray for these shoulders that have been causing pain and making work difficult. We pray that you'd bring healing and comfort and strength so that he can do his work. And God, we pray that you'd break any bondages of the enemy. We pray for any assignment against them, God. God, we come into alignment with you. And Father, we come right now to ask you to bring hope and peace and joy to the marriage and the relationship, to the emotions, to the mind, that you'd give peace and freedom from all anxiety and worry, that they may know that you are the God who heals. You're the God who provides. You're the God who gives peace. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Praise God. We're going to sing this song. Caden, bring up Mighty to Save again, would you? We're going to sing this, and we'll conclude it all here with us. Lead us out.
One needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountain.
Sing it out. Come on, sing it out.
My God is mighty. Save. He is mighty to save, forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Pastor Rocky, for that great message. We're going to take up our offering. Carla, you can come on back down. Sorry about that. She needs your microphone, Pastor Rocky. We have an announcement about the car show. Have you seen those nice-looking trophies out there? We are excited about what's coming up. Carla has a couple words about a fundraiser we're doing there. We'll let you do that right now.
So we're putting together an auction that's going to go along with the car show. And the auction, the proceeds from the auction is going to help our teens go to Nazarene Youth Conference, which is once every 4 years. It's an international conference and such an awesome opportunity for our teens to worship the Lord and serve. There's service projects that go on during that week, and that is next summer. And we want to help fund our kids' way to that conference. So we are putting together themed baskets, and many of you I talked to during your Sunday school classes this morning. But if you have questions, come see me. But we need your items. We need baskets. So if you just have leftover baskets at home that we could use to put things together, we need those. We need small items to go with some big things that we have collected to make them into a themed basket. So if you have questions, come see me. Let me know what you are able to bring. Fill that in on your little sheets of paper that you fill out that we've already done today. But let me know, communicate with me about what's coming, and we would like those items by the end of August so that we have the first 10 days of September to kind of put them together. You do not have to make your own basket. If you do, that's wonderful. But if you just have items given to us, then we will make it into a basket for you. Thank
Actually,
you.
We have not done those forms yet. So if you would get your forms out, they're in your worship folder, your connection card. Maybe it's your first, second, or third time visit here with us today. We'd love it if you'd fill out your name, address, email while the ushers are coming forward. And as we take up offering, it's just how we keep you up to speed on what's going on with the things going on at the church. I want to give a shout out as well. We had just an amazing, amazing dinner church this last Thursday. I didn't even get a full count. There had to be 50 to 60 people here. The Truth Seekers class was here. They did a great job, served food, had some great testimonies. I wanted to say to them publicly, thank you for their ministry and their service. 2 weeks from today, we have our back to school Sunday, the preschool day. I want to invite you to be a part of that. Go ahead and stay standing while we take up the offering. We're going to pray right after we're done with this and be dismissed. So give as the Lord blesses you at this time. Put those connection cards in the offering plate as they come around.
Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory.
Blessing from the Lord. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. God bless you. Thank you again for joining us. Have a wonderful day in the Lord.